Can you construct a triangle of sides 4, 5, and 6 by using the compass only once? Think about it. It seems impossible, doesn't it? You need to have an intersection of at least 2 arcs to construct a triangle, right? Turns out that you can do it while only using the compass once. Actually, you can do all the construction just by using the compass once. How is this even possible? Okay, let's clear a few things up. If you think about it, we really only construct points and not shapes. If you want to construct a pentagon, then you just construct the 5 points and then connect them up. So right now, all we're going to talk about is points. All the points that you can construct with a compass and a ruler, you can construct with a ruler while only using the compass once. To show that we can construct all points by this method, we have to show that we can do the 5 basic constructions, since any construction is just a sequence of these. Okay, here they are. Draw a straight line between 2 points. Easy. Draw a circle with a given radius. We only draw a circle to make it look nice. A circle is uniquely defined by 2 points, one its center and another a point on its circumference. Find the intersection of 2 lines. Again, we can do this directly. Find the intersections of a line and a circle, and find the intersections of 2 circles. These last 2 are the only thing that we need to prove that we can do with just a straight edge and using the compass only once. To do these 5 constructions, we'll need a few building blocks. First, making a parallel of a line with a bisected segment already on it. Now, in all the constructions, we're going to use our chance to use the compass first, by constructing one circle with its center. This will be called as the given circle. Now we'll assume that the line passes through the center of the circle, so we'll already have a bisected segment on it. We'll see how to bisect any given segment later. We'll do the construction as shown on the screen. I won't narrate each step because it just gets very boring. So BG is the parallel line that we wanted to find. And as you can see, when we move any of the points around, DG still ends up being parallel to the original line. The proof of this ends up being a simple argument of similarity of triangles. I'll leave that as an exercise to the viewer. Now you might ask that the line that I want to construct a parallel to doesn't pass through the center of the given circle. What now? So let's see how we can construct a bisected segment on a line which does not pass through the center of the circle. So we have our given circle and our line. Let's choose a point on it which will be the center of the bisected segment. Here, I'll directly draw the parallel because this line passes through the center of a circle, and we know how to draw a parallel to that. Again, I'll directly draw a parallel. And there we are. We have our bisected segment with our selected point as its center. Now we can move that line and point around to see that yes, it always does construct a bisected segment. This can be proved using the basic proportionality theorem. Now we'll see how to bisect any given segment. Here we have two lines, one with a bisector segment of any size, which we constructed by the method we just saw, and one with a segment on it which we want to bisect. So we connect the corresponding endpoints and find a point of projection using which we can project the midpoint that we already have onto the required line. This is an important concept and we're going to use it later, so remember. By moving these lines around, we can see that yes, it does bisect the segment that we want. Again, this can be proved by similarity or the basic proportionality theorem. We've seen now how to construct parallels and how to bisect segments. But there's one more thing that we need. Constructing perpendiculars. Let's see how to do it. Here we have a line and our given circle. Now we want to construct a perpendicular to CD at C. It can be any point, but I will just choose C. First we'll choose any point on the given circle. Now we construct a parallel to CD which goes through E, our chosen point. Then we mark the other intersection of the parallel line with the circle. Then we will find the diametrically opposite point of E by constructing a diameter through the center. Then connect the diametrically opposite point and the other intersection to get the perpendicular line. Now, by Thales' theorem, these two lines are perpendicular. Then we can just construct a parallel of the perpendicular line that we've just drawn, which passes through C. And we're done. Now we can move it around and see that yes, it is always perpendicular. Now we're ready to see how we can find the intersection of a line and a circle. Say we have a circle, which is just two points, and a line, and we want to find their intersection points. Well, we have the given circle. The key idea here is that we will scale down the circle with a point of projection so that it falls on the given circle. Then we can find the intersections in the given circle. Once we have those, we can project them back up to their original position. Okay, so here we have our invisible circle drawn as a dotted circle and the given circle. So we'll first construct the corresponding point to D on the given circle. Now we have two sets of points and we can find the point of projection. I'll just hide a few lines that we don't need anymore to make the picture less cluttered. Then we'll pick a random point on the line and cast that segment CI onto the scaled down version. Again, I'll hide a few things we don't need anymore. Look at that. These two figures are perfectly similar, scaled down by that point of projection. Now we have the intersections. We can just cast them back up and see that they do indeed fall on the correct points. Now the only thing left to do is to find how to construct the intersections of two circles. We'll need one last thing before that, and that is the radical axis. The radical axis is the locus of all points which have equal powers with respect to two circles. What this means for our purposes is that the lengths of the tangents from that point to the two circles are equal. The radical axis of two circles always passes through their intersection points if they intersect. This is what we're going to use. Why might this be true? Because we can think of the intersection points as having tangents of length 0 to both circles. Also, if you take three circles and construct the three radical axes of the three pairs formed, they will be concurrent. Again, why might this be true? Because if you consider just two axes and see their intersection point, at that point, the power with respect to the first and the second circle will be equal. Also, the power with respect to the second and the third circle will be equal. And so, just by the rules of equality, we can see that the power with respect to the first and the third circle will be equal. So it must fall on the radical axis of the first and the third circle. The third fact we'll need is that the radical axis is always perpendicular to the line joining the two centers. This can be shown to be true using congruency of triangles. Okay, so here we have two circles. I've drawn them with dotted lines because they're not really there, but I'll draw them for our benefit. So first what we'll do is we'll construct the midpoint of BD. Why are we doing this? Well, we can think of it as a circle centered on the midpoint, and BD are diametrically opposite points on the circle. Since D is an intersection point of circles E and C, the radical axis must pass through it. Also, it will be perpendicular to CE. So we can construct this. As we saw before, how to construct a perpendicular line. Again, we can do the same thing with circles A and E. The radical axis will pass through point B and be perpendicular to line AE. These two axes intersect at a point. Now we know that the three radical axes of three circles are concurrent. So the radical axis of A and C, which is the one we're after, must pass through that intersection point. Also, it's going to be perpendicular to AC. So we can construct it now. And there we go. There it is. Right now, the circles are not intersecting, so the axis doesn't intersect any circle. But if we move them around so that they do intersect, we can see that it always passes through their intersection points. So you can just use the method we saw before, where we intersected a line with a circle, to get the intersection points of these two circles. And with that, we've completed all the five basic constructions with a compass and a ruler by only using the compass once. And that's the proof. And so now we've completed all the required tasks to show that everything is constructible using just the straight edge and a given circle in the plane. And that's it. Thank you for watching.